And he asked me, "Well, what do you think? Is gold dead?" And I said, "I don't think so. Actually, I can really imagine that gold will go to new all-time highs over the next couple of months." And he said, "No way, that this is impossible. Gold is dead." So if you see this this pessimism already in the sector, people that are really into gold, that love their gold, I think that's quite telling. And you know, now we're trading slightly below 1800. Actually, it doesn't take too much to go to new all-time highs. But of course, I mean, I'm not super excited about the price developments over the last couple of months, but we shouldn't get too greedy. Gold was up 26% last year. It was up, I think, 15% the year before. Year to date, in US dollar terms, we are down, I think, 6 or 7%. So it's not that bad. And again, companies are delivering. They are producing record amounts of free cash flow. So it makes me pretty confident, I would say.
Yeah, that's really interesting, the conversation you had with somebody that you described as a diehard gold bug who is telling you that, "Sorry, Ronnie, gold is dead." And isn't that, it's interesting. I had a similar conversation on 2 days ago with a peer of mine in YouTube land, right? He runs a channel like mine, and I is sort of a peer, and we share notes on our portfolios every couple of months. His core focus is cryptocurrencies, however. You know, he does invest in precious metals and some other stuff, but he was grilling me because he said, "Jay, like, if gold isn't performing in this market, right, with all these supporting factors, maybe the narrative is over. Maybe that story is over." And similar to you, I was like, "This is great news." That's the most bullish thing I've heard in the gold sector. And I take your story the same way. I mean, it's difficult to be a contrarian investor. It's really, really hard, right? It takes a lot of balls, like, to step out when everyone else is running away. But all of my mentors in the space, that's when they acted. And you know, I want to pull up a Rick Rule quote that I just love so much. He called me in March of 2020 when the sky was falling, and he said, "Jay, it's times like these when the rest of the world is on the ground in the fetal position. That's when you have to kick the door down and storm the room," right? And I love it, right? But he's right.
Yeah.
And he's built a career off that advice.
And I think, you know, the combination of extremely negative sentiment, no interest in the sector at all, and pretty positive fundamentals, that's something that I like. And you know, my wife, for example, you know, she always buys the Christmas decoration, not in November or in December. She buys it in January when it's 50% off. So
Right.
she's a contrarian. And actually, in our funds, we're constantly buying. We've got some stink bits in the market. So I like this current environment. And you know, the big question is, of course, what is it going to take to make gold move again? And I think, you know, I think the biggest opportunity costs, first of all, are in the on the equity side. As long as U.S. equity markets just roar from one all-time high to another, I think this will give gold a hard time. However, over the last couple of days, we saw some volatility back again, and actually, gold was one of the very, very few assets that did really well. So my thesis is always that gold has this enormous amount of intuition, of intelligence, because you know, the price of gold is influenced by so many different factors, so many different buyers and sellers from all over the globe. So I think there's quite a lot of wisdom, actually, the wisdom of the crowds in the price of gold. So I think that perhaps it is discounting that tapering is happening. It's going to happen sooner or later, and I think the whole you know, the whole discussion in markets, when does it start? I think this is kind of getting a little bit boring. That's like the alcoholic that tells us that, well, you know, in 5 months from now I'll drink one glass of bourbon less per day, and at some point, you know, I will only drink half a bottle a day anymore. I think, you know, that the price of gold really, it hates this whole uncertainty. I think once we've got a date regarding tapering, I think this should be a positive driver. Then, as I've said, opportunity costs coming from the equity side, but then also cryptos. As you know, Jay, we've got two funds that actually combine Bitcoin and gold, another one with cryptocurrencies and mining stocks, and we actually love the volatility of the Bitcoin space. We embrace the volatility by writing options. But it is obvious that when it comes to, you know, talking to journalists, they don't care about gold at the moment. They want to sell their stories. And yeah, obviously writing about Bitcoin and the whole DeFi space, that's much more exciting for them. And of course, that's what people want to read about at the moment.
Yeah. And that's the business of media, which I think is so important to recognize. As you said, they're in the business of selling stories, right? So they'll publish headlines and all, whatever's going to generate the click, because that picks the ad revenue. And that's the business model. And losing sight of that can be disastrous if you think you're getting unbiased information, when really it's sensationalism is what sells, right? And so exactly, let's sell them what they want. In this case, it might be crypto. I love all that. You know, I definitely subscribe to Nassim Taleb's thesis that nothing stress tests as effectively as time. And, you know, I wouldn't call myself a gold bug by any stretch. However, I hold a lot of gold equities and gold, and that's just because I can't ignore the past, right? You look at our past, you know, we're not talking about 13 years. We're not talking about 100 years, right? You got to look deeper than that. And I absolutely always, I think if you study history and pay attention to currencies, I don't understand.